Here we are in Wyoming in the Laramie Range, and I want to introduce Bob Dorn, one of the two willow experts in North America. And Bob's an old friend of mine and even mentored me for a long time. Neither one of us knew he was doing it, but it worked. And Bob has written The Flora of Wyoming, Montana, the Black Hills, many treatments on different groups besides the willows, numerous species. He's a active functioning taxonomist, and today he's going to spend some time with us talking about the ecology, the evolution, and a lot of the morphological features related to willows.
Intuitively, you might think that willows started out as small little shrubs and then over time evolved into these big trees. Well, it's exactly the opposite. The willow started as big trees and then evolved into little tiny creeping Arctic alpine shrubs later. We don't really know what the relationship, early relationship is of willows. They're in the early fossil record, but we think they evolved someplace in Eastern Asia, probably in the subtropics or the warm temperate area of Eastern Asia. And they expanded out from there mostly into temperate, north temperate regions, and then finally into the Arctic. There's only, for example, in South America, there's only a single native species of willow. So it looks like the tropics were a significant barrier to the expansion of willows, because most of them went to the north temperate regions. The willows that evolved from that Asian location probably went more westerly first before they came to North America. So our earliest willows in North America probably came by way of Africa, when African continent was adjacent to North and South America. Those are all primitive willows that are related to each other on those three continents. Now the willows have catkins. Flowers are in catkins, which looks like this. And in the primitive willows, you can usually tell those because the little bract at the base of each capsule tends to drop off once the catkins mature. Whereas in the advanced species of willows, the bracts remain on there. And in addition, the bracts of the primitive ones are real pale colored, whereas most of the bracts of the advanced ones are dark colored. So that's an easy way to tell whether you got a primitive species or advanced species. And there are actually two subgenera in North America. The primitive group is subgenus Salix, and the advanced group is subgenus Vitrix. And that's a pretty good way to tell which subgenus you have, is just looking at the catkins. And in terms of identifying willows, the pistillate catkins are your best way to easily identify the species. You can identify them with staminate catkins, but it's much more difficult. And sometimes with no catkins, just using the leaves, but that's even more difficult. This is a primitive willow in North America, at least. It's one of the most primitive we have. And the reason we can tell this is it has primitive types bud scales. There are two types of bud scales in willows. Well, first of all, the willows have only a single scale over the bud, one scale only, and that's fairly unique. Most plants, shrubby plants, tree plants, have more than one scale. So that's one of the easiest ways to tell willows from other plants, is to look at the bud scale. If there's only one, it's probably a willow. This particular one has a bud scale that's a primitive scale, which is a scale that has free margins that kind of come around and overlap. So there's a slit down the side and that overlaps. Most of the more advanced willows have that slit fused, so it forms a little cap over the bud, so there's no slit at all. So that's how you can tell the primitive ones from the more advanced ones. This one being a tree willow, the primitive willows are usually trees, the more advanced willows are shrubs, and the Arctic alpine shrubs, the ones that creep along the ground, are the smallest of the willows, some only just a centimeter or two high. Here we have a crack willow with catkins, and you can tell this is a primitive willow because it's a tree, first of all. Secondly, the bracts and the catkins tend to drop off as the catkins mature. The reason it's called a crack willow is because the branches break off real easily. Here we are in the Laramie Range, about 7,500, 8,000 feet in Wyoming. And we have a bog here in the background. It has about a dozen species of willows in it. Some of them are isolated here since Pleistocene glaciation. As far as the 12 species of willows that are occurring in this one area, that's more species than a lot of eastern states have in the entire state. Because in the east we have habitats that are closed in. They have canopies over most everything. Whereas here they like to be out in the open where the sun can hit them continuously.
Where then, like in the west, where there's a lot of open areas, is probably the highest areas of diversity for willows?
Highest diversity is probably in Alaska and northern British Columbia, and the Rocky Mountains follow close behind that.
You hear a lot about hybridization. You can't tell willows because they hybridize. I think in the past, many years ago, you disagreed with that, to me, in a statement like that.
Hybridization has been overstressed in willows. They certainly hybridize, but most of the trouble has been with the great infraspecific variability in the species, which makes them difficult to identify. A lot of things that were called hybrids weren't hybrids at all. So even though they do hybridize, it should not be so overstressed like it has been in the past.
Are all willows wetlands species?
Just about. There are two exceptions. One is the schooler willow, which grows in upland areas of the mountains. The other is what's called the prairie willow, which is in the eastern U.S., and it tends to grow in grassy prairies where it's open again.
And you think of them with any special adaptations to being able to grow in water, or just the tolerance, have the tolerance for being in water?
They certainly have the tolerance, just like cottonwoods do. Cottonwoods can be flooded for months of the year and doesn't seem to affect them particularly. And willows are kind of the same way.
You'd mentioned today that there still is not a lot of DNA support or evidence to tease apart a lot of these willow questions as far as the taxonomy?
Yeah, the genetic data is still pretty sketchy for willows. I recognize two subgenera in North America. Some people recognize three. I don't think maybe some of the Eurasian workers would recognize more, even though they're not that familiar with our willows. And we probably won't know for sure how many there ought to be until we have more genetic data available. Here we have another primitive willow, but this is a shrub willow. It's probably the most advanced section in the primitive subgenus Salix. It's section longifolii, and it's restricted to North America. It has extremely narrow leaves, and that makes it real easy to identify. Catkins, again, have pale-colored bracts, which drop off as the catkins mature. So that puts it in that primitive subgenus. Again, the narrow leaves are easily identified. It grows from coast to coast in North America, just about, and it's divided into two subspecies. The eastern subspecies comes almost to the Rocky Mountains. The western subspecies takes up from there and goes to the Pacific coast. There are also a couple of related species, mostly on the west coast, but some in the Rocky Mountains as well. Here we have another member of the primitive subgenus Salix in a different section, section Salicaster. This is a member of the boreal forest up in Canada and Alaska primarily. It was probably pushed down here into Wyoming during Pleistocene glaciation 10,000 plus years ago, and then when the glaciers receded, it persisted here because conditions were right for it in this cold, wet bog. Here you see the staminate catkin for this species. It's often called the autumn willow because it tends to mature its catkins in summer or early fall. It has more than two stamens per flower, unlike most of the advanced willows, which have only two stamens per flower, in some cases only a single stamen per flower. Here we have the pistillate catkins of the autumn willow, the staminate we just saw. So you can see the catkins are fairly short. They're kind of as long as they are wide. That's a good characteristic to go by sometimes too. Here's another species of this cold bog, another boreal forest species that was probably stranded here after glaciation. This is called Salix candida, and it's easy to identify because of the white tomentose underside of the leaves. Here we have another advanced willow, more or less advanced. This is called Beb willow, Salix bebiana. It has a number of features that make it quite easy to identify. It tends to grow on the edges of wet places rather than out in the wet itself. Most willow species, of course, are in wet places or fairly moist places. There's a couple of exceptions. For the most part, willows are pioneering species on moist or wet, disturbed habitats, open habitats. This one has several features, like I said, that are easy to make to identify it. The catkins have capsules that have long, narrow beaks at their tips, and the bract at the base of the capsule is pale colored, which is unusual for an advanced willow. Usually the pale colored ones are in the primitive subgenus. Another feature is the color of the twigs. The twigs of the year are reddish brown, and if you go back to the previous year's twig, they're kind of mottled white and brownish. Two more features of this species: the capsules tend to have the tips curl back, full curl, so that the tip touches the base of the capsule when it's mature. Also, the stalk at the base of the capsule is quite long, usually as long as the bract or even exceeding the length of the bract. Here we have another advanced species. This is Salix monticola, a mountain willow. It has leaves that are glaucous on the other underside. This is usually a useful characteristic. See if we can get a close-up of that. Glaucous means that it has a whitish bloom on the underside that you can easily rub off with your finger. Some species have that and some species do not, so that's a good key character that puts them into different groups. Here we have another more advanced willow. This is Salix boothii, booth willow. Happens to be one I named myself. It has leaves that are green on both sides, unlike the previous one we saw that had glaucous leaves on the underside. So we can take a close up look at this one just to see what that looks like. Here you have a upper side and an underside, and they're virtually the same green. This one may be a little darker, but you don't have that glaucous bloom on the underside. Here we have another willow called the plain leaf willow, Salix planifolia. It has glaucous leaves on the underside again. And one other feature, you see the catkins here are sessile. There's no stalk to the base of them. They're right against the stem. And notice the reddish stem up the growth of previous year, the reddish stem. That's a characteristic of this species as well. Other species have the catkins on stalks rather than being right flush with the stem, such as this one here. So you can see the stalk at the base of the catkins with a few small leaves on that stalk. So that's a good feature to look for sometimes to identify these things. Here's another advanced willow. This one has several features that make it fairly easy to identify. We'll have to take a closer look at it to see those. Notice the twigs of the year. They have this whitish, bluish-white bloom, and there's only a couple of species that have that, so that narrows things down pretty rapidly. This is Salix geyeriana, named for Carl Geyer, a German botanist who founded in Idaho back in 1843. The catkins are fairly short and plump, barely longer than wide. That's another feature that will help identify this. And the flower bracts, again, are pale, which is unusual for an advanced willow. Here we have another willow that's typically low-growing like this. This is the short fruit willow, Salix brachycarpa. It has very short fruits, that's why it gets its name. And I can show a close-up of that. You see the catkins are barely longer than they are wide. And also notice that the leaves are glaucous on the underside on this species. And the stalk on the catkins is prominent with the leaves nearly as big as the other leaves. That's also a prominent feature of this species. Here we have an exception to the rule that willows grow in wet places. This species grows in upland forests, probably established when this was open after a fire or something similar, and then they persist for many, many years after they're established. This species is easy to recognize. Incidentally, it's called Salix scholariana, schooler willow. It's easy to recognize because the leaves are obovate for the most part. They have very broad tips on them, and we can see that and get one closer to the camera here. I can get one off. And see the unusual shape there with that broad tip toward broadish tip that it has and the long tapering base on it. And they're glaucous on the underside like many of the other willows. They have that bluish white bloom, which we can turn over and see.
And I want to really thank you for taking the time to share all that information and knowledge with us. Thank you.
Sure. Okay, I'm getting a little old in age, and the other willow expert in North America is older than I am, so anybody interested in taking up willows, the field is wide open.